inundating people with toxic, cancer-causing, death-causing medications. So, what is this epigenetics thing? I mean, it's a word that's not really familiar to most of the general public. Well, most of us know about genetics, and that is the information that the DNA that we get from mom and the DNA that we get from dad, and it comes together, and poof, here we are. So you have all the genetic information that's going to start your life. But there's another part of this, because from the time of conception until the time you take your last breath, epigenetics comes into play. Because everything that you experience, whether it's emotional, whether it's positive or negative, whether it's environmental, good or bad, is going to have some influence on the way that your genes express themselves. The mere fact that I'm up here doing all of this is a result of my genes, my genetics, and also environmental influences, epigenetic influences throughout my life. So most of us remember in high school this deal about the double helix. Remember that? And the chromosomes and the double helix and such. And we look at that in high school and go, oh, that's pretty cool, but nobody really understands it. Well, now they do understand it. In the 1990s, the Human Genome Project set out to identify what was in that double helix, that ladder, if you will. And then in the 2000s, they said, hey, okay, well, we got this down. Now let's see how all of this combines to give us characteristics. And that's what genes do. Genes are kind of a set of what's called nucleotides. So DNA really is pretty simple. You look at 3 billion DNA nucleotide bases, and that seems like a lot, and it seems like it's overwhelming, but it's really pretty simple because there's only 4 types of nucleotide bases. And to make it even more simple, there's 2 pairs, and they're held together by what's called hydrogen bonds. So all up and down that ladder, all up and down, are combinations of these 2 pairs. So within the 3 billion nucleotide bases, there are approximately 25,000 genes that make us who we are. And genes are specific sequences of amino acids formed from groups of nucleotide bases that make proteins that carry out instructions for life's functions. So epigenetics really describes the symphony of life. Sonia mentioned that symphony of life. Genes are instructions for what to do and where and when to do it. And epigenetics refers to alterations in normal gene functions by activating or deactivating genes. So good lifestyle choices can turn good genes on and bad genes off, and poor lifestyle choices can turn poor genes on, bad genes on, the good ones off. So these things are actually can be passed down from generation to generation. Our lifestyle choices, what we do today, can be passed down from generation to generation. How many? Science says the 3rd and 4th generation. Now, has anybody heard this before? How many people? Give me a shout out. The sins of the fathers or the poor lifestyle choices can be passed down from generation to generation. We're told this in God's Word. This is nothing new. This has been there ever since. So we have to understand that when we make good choices in life, not only is it going to affect our genetic expression, but also it's going to be passed down from generation to generation, all the way down to 3rd and 4th. And, you know, when I first kind of started really looking into the research and understanding that science is now saying all of this, it really makes God's word even become more alive to me. And it puts more of a profound responsibility on us, doesn't it? Doesn't it? To make sure that we're taking care of ourselves, not only for our own sake, but also for the sake of our children and our children's children. So poor lifestyle choices of the parents create a predisposition. They do not create a destiny. We are responsible to be aware of the predispositions, evaluate them, and then eliminate them. We are responsible for our own choices. As much as 80 to 90% of your health is determined by environmental factors, and as little as 10 to 20% are actually determined by genetic predisposition. And the most likely causes of those changes are pesticides, synthetic chemicals, industrial chemicals. More than 85,000 of them are in our world in which we live and breathe and have our existence. So the kinds of chemicals that have actually been studied out there that pass down to third and fourth generations is this list right here. I'm not going to go through these, but this is just a partial list. And some of the other things that influence transgenerational afflictions are also emotions. The emotional baggage of unforgiveness, resentment, bitterness. Those kinds of things will pass down as well. So how do these things pass down from generation to generation? Is it really damage to the DNA? Is it alterations in the DNA? No, it's not. And there's good news to that. One of them is that these things pass down through what's called epigenetic tags. So when we have a life of addiction, or we have a life of anger, bitterness, resentment, any of those kinds of things that create a characterization of us as we move through our life, there's a little tag that's placed on that gene that should be activated and is not, or should not be activated and it is. And for the ones that should be activated and are not, there's a little tag that that's put on there that says out of order, nobody's home. And so that gene does not express the way that it's supposed to. So good lifestyle choices can create tags that will support your normal genetic, epigenetic makeup. Better sleep, more energy, healthy weight, healthy emotions. Those are the kind of things that good tags will be placed on those genes and said, hey, I'm open for business. This door is wide open. And then there's poor lifestyle choices, that such as anxiety, obesity, heart disease, and diabetes, there's a tag that will be put on a good gene and says closed for the day or closed for a lifetime. Do not enter, do not disturb. So the cool thing about this really is that these tags can actually be removed. You are not destined to this. Just because mom had diabetes, well, my mother had diabetes, and that's why I have it. My parents had cancer. My grandparents had cancer. My mom was obese. Whatever it is, that doesn't have to be you. It doesn't have to be you at all. You can change those. You might have a tendency towards something, but you just make the changes in your lifestyle, make sure that those kinds of genes don't get expressed. It's that simple. That's not your destiny. Your destiny is who you choose to make it. We're going to talk about how genes are expressed in silence here. Genes are expressed in silence through two mechanisms. One is called methylation, and one is called acetylation. Now, if you take your DNA, which is crammed into your nucleus, if you spread it out, it would be about 6 meters. So how do you get all that DNA into your nucleus? Well, it wraps around itself almost like spools, threads around in a spool. So you can wrap a lot of DNA around a spool. Well, if you look here, there's little brown things down there. Those are spools, and the DNA is wrapped around that and crammed into your nucleus. So when we talk about methylation, methylation is actually, for the most part, is going to prevent genes from being expressed. Okay? So what these spools do is they go like this. They huddle together, and you can see that in the top picture there, where the DNA is inaccessible because it's so jammed, it's wound up, and you can't get to it to duplicate it to create a protein. Acetylation actually takes that spool and unwinds it. And so you have a little copy machine that goes over top of certain portions. It'll go over top of gene. It'll make a copy and then it'll make a protein, and something will happen as a result. That's kind of what you want. But there are times when a gene shouldn't be expressed, and there's times when it should. And under normal circumstances, the body works that way. But there's a lot of things that interfere with the normal function of genes that will make them shut down when they're not supposed to shut down, or make them express when they're not supposed to express. So research shows that the environment in the womb profoundly affects offspring health. So when you get pregnant women who eat poorly, they will go on to be more susceptible, their children, to obesity, cardiovascular disease, cancer, allergies, etc. Women who smoke will have a greater chance of having offspring who have asthma, and will cause approximately 50,000 gene mutations. This study was done on women who were smoking for 2 years. 50,000 gene mutations just from that. Any addictions like this, no matter where it's coming from, will have profound effects on your genetic makeup. This is so important that there's a lot of research here, even within nutrition. If you're giving yourself adequate nutrition, the proper nutrition that our bodies require every day, it's going to have an influence on your gene expression. The epigenetic studies are proving this out as well. Nutrients can reverse or change epigenetic phenomena such as DNA methylation and histone modifications, which is acetylation, thereby modifying the expression of critical genes associated with physiological and pathological changes, including embryonic development, aging, and carcinogenesis. So, this is one study that showed that that maternal obesity impairs offspring health, and if you look at the bottom there, it's passed down to the second and third generation. They're finding these kinds of things consistently now. In other words, our health is not only determined by what we think and say and do, and the way we act, and the things we put on us and in us, but also what our parents and grandparents and great-grandparents ate, thought, and did. So a recap, there's a difference between epigenetics and gene mutations. Genes are activated and deactivated mostly through a process of methylation and acetylation. Gene mutations involves actual damages to DNA. So on the top, you have an example of the different kinds of DNA damage that can occur. Your body also is very sophisticated in that when you have DNA damage, you have a repair crew that actually goes in and can repair genes, repair DNA to a certain extent when it's functioning properly, and that's the key. DNA tags are associated with changes that can be actually removed. If we have done something to ourselves in our lifetime to create a characteristic of our behavior or the way that our body functions that we don't particularly care for, it's not healthy for us, we can change that. We can pull that tag off and say open for business. So what are the kinds of things that cause these epigenetic gene malfunctions and DNA mutations? You have environmental toxins, negative emotions, unhealthy lifestyle choices, generational influences. I want to focus a little bit on environmental toxins. A lot of you may have seen this, but I like including it in every single presentation that I do because it's so profoundly important that the Environmental Working Group did a study of women, 10 women, tested their umbilical cord blood when they delivered their babies. They found a total of 287 chemicals present with an average of 200 between them. 217 toxic to the brain, 208 cause birth defects, 180 known to cause cancer, all traced back to mother's diet. The poster child for understanding the environmental influences of chemicals in our life is BPA, bisphenol. And originally started out by a pharmaceutical company who wanted to create an artificial estrogen to give to women. There was competition between BPA and DES. DES won out. BPA was put back on the shelf. DES was later in the 40s and in the 50s, DES was later found to cause cancer, like a lot of these chemicals do, and was taken off the market. BPA came back into the market because somebody had realized that you can create plastics from BPA. And so that's what we see today. There's been a lot of research on the adverse health effects of BPA. BPA has been shown to alter at least 200 genes. There have been over 200 articles written on this. And it's an active endocrine disruptor. It also causes breast cancer, prostate cancer, obesity, type 2 diabetes, and so on. Not a pretty picture. And yet it's in our environment. Everything that we are exposed to, we have to be wise. We have to be streetwise when we're out there. You got to know. Get your toolbox filled with information. You got to know that things are going to harm you and your children out there. So we typically see these kinds of things, for instance, on the lining inside cans, we see in plastic bottles. But there's another one that you're exposed to every single day that can have profound effects on you. Receipts. Really? On the front of those receipts is a plastic coating. And if you touch that so many times, your sweat's on your hand may be a little wet. If you're just playing with the receipt in your pocket, boom, you can get an absorption of BPA into your system. Even some of the gene mutations are associated with breast cancer. Now, a lot of people understand, they've heard of BRCA1, BRCA2, and people understand, oh, you don't want BRCA1 and BRCA2. Well, the truth is that BRCA1 and BRCA2 are actually cancer-protective genes that have been turned off.
Oh, my gosh.
And what you want to do is turn them back on. And you know what? That is possible. Now, I know personally, in our organization, personally know two women who have been diagnosed with stage 4 breast cancer. And they told them, surgery, chemo, and radiation, and who knows how long you're going to live if you're going to live in 5 years. That's what they do. That's what they're trained to do. And it's not their fault, because a lot of them, they're just doing what they think is right for people. It's all pharmaceutical driven. A lot of money here, and people are getting killed because of it. These genes can be turned back on. These two women decided to go to somebody that I have a personal relationship with in Houston, who deals with these kind of things very naturally. And she can turn those genes back on. She does very sophisticated DNA testing, and she can find out which genes are not functioning properly, which ones have mutated. And she can, by taking that very close look at the DNA, she knows how to turn those things back on. And it's very, very sophisticated. And within 2 weeks of treatment by this doctor, and those of you who want to know who she is. I will give you some contact information, or you can ask me afterwards and I'll tell you. Within 2 weeks after going to see her, they were cancer cell free.
No surgery.
We know these two people personally. And my wife has gone to her as well for a couple of issues that she was UTIs, suffering for years and years and years and years. One antibiotic after another, over 100 times in our 30 years. She went to see her. She didn't go see her, actually, you don't need to. You just communicate with her and she sends a DNA test to you. You don't need to go see her. Come to find out, nobody else even thought about testing for this. They couldn't anyway, because this is not something that would be on their radar screen. Ended up, she had a blood fluke, a parasite that had lodged in her bladder that this doctor picked up on through her DNA testing. And that was the cause of all the inflammation and chronic infections. Dealt with that parasite. She is now UTI infection free. She also had cancer cells as a result of the chronic inflammation. She's cancer cell free at this time. It can be simple. It can be simple, folks. It really can. It does not have to be complicated. We know a lot about what to do, don't we? I mean, we know a lot about what to do. This just make this another part of the puzzle, another option for you as well. Lyme disease, same thing. There are gene mutations that prevent some people from fighting off the Lyme disease. Under normal circumstances, we should be able to do that. There are two gene mutations that have been identified. And if you have these gene mutations, you don't have the ability to fight off that insult. A really hot topic is vitamin B9, folate. There are people out there who have gene mutation that prevents conversion of folate that you get in food to active folate in your body. And folate is incredibly important, not only for neurotransmitters in your brain. A lot of people who have depression, it's a simple gene mutation. It's a simple gene mutation that can be overridden. These emotional disturbances, cardiovascular disease, obesity, all of these things are now starting to be related to this particular gene mutation. It's the MTHFR, methyl tetrahydrofolate reductase gene mutation. Even in autism, same thing. About 60% of the population has one of the mutation in one form or another, and I'll get into that a little bit. Here, the way that this works is whether or not it's folic acid or folate, it eventually has to be converted to a bioactive form of vitamin B9 in order to function properly and form your neurotransmitters. So if you look here on the bottom, it says MTHFR, and underneath that it's 5-methyl-THF active vitamin B9. That's a bridge. That's a conversion bridge. It's almost like a gate. Folate in a semi-converted form tries to cross that bridge to become bioactive. And that gate is either going to be partway closed, partway open, and so on, or all the way open. And to the degree that someone has that mutation, it will determine whether or not that gate doesn't open, or partially opens, or opens all the way. And when it's open all the way, you can have a conversion to active B9. If it opens partway, you'll get some of it coming through. You understand what I'm saying with this? You can have variations of that mutation in terms of how much of that actually gets through that gate to become active vitamin B9 that will form your neurotransmitters in your brain. So these are the two types. I'm not going to go into depth with this, but there's two types, 677 and 1298. You can have either one or both, and they can be heterozygous or homozygous. Okay, these are really hot topics in epigenetics, vaccines, autism, ADHD, and gluten disorders, and I'm going to go through some of those. I do want to tell you that there are some in the medical community who are starting to realize that how harmful vaccines are. This particular doctor here said, if you look at the bottom, Dr. Rachel Ross, she said, I apologize from the bottom of my heart to any children and parents that I have unknowingly harmed. I had no idea how destructive these vaccines can be. This is Dr. Tony Bark. She says that in her practice, the kids that have been vaccinated are the ones that she sees with so many disorders such as asthma, panic disorders, and so on, OCD, autism. She says the ones that come into her office for wellness checks, children, the unvaccinated children, not one has those problems. Dr. Gary Cole, MD, he said his father's ability to use his arms was pretty much destroyed because of a bogus swine flu vaccine for which he got vaccinated for. Destroyed his nerves in his arms. There's also a connection between polio vaccine. It started in the 1950s when the Salk and Savin developed the original polio vaccine. And they knew this at the time. They used rhesus monkey kidney cells to develop the vaccine. Those rhesus monkey kidney cells was contaminated with a virus called SV40.
Really?
Simian virus 40. They knew it. Distributed between 1956 and 1961, I think, over 100 million doses were just given here in the United States alone. The vast majority of those were contaminated with that virus. That virus causes cancer. And if that virus activates in your body because your immune system just cannot keep it in check, you're going to die. There's no treatment for it. And kind of like herpes simplex, you know, when you get out in the sun, you get these cold sores. This virus requires your immune system to be pretty well shot before it actually activates. But once it does, you're up a creek. And the sad thing about it is that this virus passes down from generation to generation to generation. Mm-hmm. And even across the world, up until 1995 in Italy, they were using the same cultures around the world. They stopped the United States in 1961, but the rest of the world were using it. So really, you have billions and billions and billions of people who have this virus. And this doctor that I was telling you in Houston says she sees this all the time in her DNA testing. She says it's very common, very common. And as long as your immune system is functioning, you can keep it in check. But if you look down here at the bottom, you'll see that brain tumors, you'll see this virus in 37%, osteogenic sarcoma 26, bone tumors 34, mesothelioma, which is lung cancer, see 90%. 90%. And so they're starting to turn their head towards this virus, which they didn't really have a confirmatory test for until late 90s. And now they're starting to turn their attention towards this virus. Now that the pharmaceutical companies who created it are immune from lawsuits and being held responsible for what they did, now they're starting to pay attention to it because the pharmaceutical companies are a little bit relaxed more about it. So what if you find it? You can't do anything to me for it. So where are vaccines made? The vast majority of them are made in China. There are quality control issues, as you might imagine. I do want you to take a look at this. The recommendation is that they're really pushing, even me as a doc, the nurses in the hospital, everybody's being pushed to have their flu vaccine. I'd never have a flu vaccine, ever.
All right.
Ever.
All right.
And the sad thing is they're encouraging pregnant women to have vaccines, and they're almost twisting their arm to do this.
Yeah.
Take a look at the bottom here.
What are you doing here, John?
250 times the acceptable levels of thimerosal, which are high by itself. The acceptable level is high. 250 times higher in a fetus. That's what this beautiful growing baby is being exposed through to when those vaccines are given. And you know, honestly, nobody here needs to beat themselves up about anything, about what you've done in the past. It's what you do from today on. Because we were in the same boat. We vaccinated our children early on before I wised up. And what has happened in the past has happened in the past. We don't know. I didn't know, and I'm a doc. And I didn't know until I really started doing research into this. Dr. Russell Blaylock, retired neurosurgeon and now health advocate. He's got several books. He's got a nice website out there. Says, I can't think of anything more insane than vaccinating a pregnant woman. Autism has, if you look in the lower left, in 1975, 1 in 5,000. This is 2015, I think it was, it's now less than 1 in 50. Why? Did the human race change here? Or is this something being done to us by profiteers and pharmaceutical company? Dr. Andrew Retzke, he's a professor of genetic medicine, human genetics at the University of Chicago, says there's a certain range between 9 and 30 weeks of gestation where the fetus is very vulnerable to chemical insults. They'll tell you, medical community will tell you, pediatricians and most other well-intentioned people will tell you that the vaccines, the DDP vaccines that you get, do not cause autism. And if you don't do what they want, they'll kick you out of the practice. So they're highly encouraging you to have these vaccinations. And it's more and more and more. You wait till next year, a year after that. I think it goes up to 60. And it's now 40 over a lifetime. But I want to show you something. This is a package insert for this vaccine.